He's getting the F part.
God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. Therefore, he will not fear. We will not fear. Though the earth give away and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea. Though its waters roar and foam and the mountains quake with their surging. There's a river whose stream makes glad the city of God, the holy place where the Most High dwells. Today we come to celebrate the life of Pastor Tim Butler. Let's give God a hand clap of praise for the man of God on today. The scripture teaches us that we do not mourn as the world, those who have no hope, but we're here to celebrate the man of God who loved the Lord with all his heart. Amen. I might even add, he was a genius. Amen. We had the privilege of hearing him come and minister to us in the city of Pontiac, and we just were in awe at his genius and how much he loved the Lord. And so we come today to celebrate. First, we're going to start off with a song, In the Garden, that we're going to follow the instructions that the family has given us, and we'll listen to the song, In the Garden. So I would have told you that I'm going away to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we're so grateful that your love is present in this room. We thank you that Pastor Tim has led a life and you have blessed him to know you, and he's shared your great gospel, not only with the world, but with his family, with his wife, his loving wife, and his children. And we're so grateful for this opportunity to know that he is in the presence of the Lord Almighty. Strengthen the family, Lord God, is our prayer. Comfort them like only you can. Let them know, as we often hear, that earth has no sorrow that heaven cannot heal. Bless them. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. At this time, the family is allowing for friends to have remarks. We ask that you keep them under 2 minutes. So if anyone would like to, and then the family will come after the friends, but if you'd like to have some remarks, please feel free to stand and come up and share your memory at this time. Any friends like to come? No? Yes.
Yeah, I came to this family about 10 years ago, and I met Chrissy, and we had a lot of good things to talk about with this dad. I just feel sorry for you guys, because I'm feeling what you're feeling, and we gotta put the joy back in our hearts, because that's what he wants. And I love everyone to be here. And don't get to say very much, but he had a lot of good things to say about a lot of things. He was really smart, educated.
Not usually a loss for words.
I didn't write a script, sorry. But,
share memory.
Yes. I didn't know him very well, but I knew him because I knew his family. I knew his son, I knew his daughter, and they have great character. They're really good people. So I felt like I knew him because I knew them. You know, and I just want to talk about legacy. Mm-hmm. All right. He leaves a legacy of love. And these people that pass away live through us, through the things that they taught us. And sometimes we forget, and sometimes we don't remember the way they taught us. So I want to encourage you all, don't forget where you come from. Don't forget the wisdom that was imparted to you by people before you that are older than you. Our elders are very important.
True.
And this culture has a way, I don't want to get on a soapbox here, but we have a way of tossing our elders aside as if we don't need them anymore. But the problem is they're just full of wisdom, and they're full of love. So I want to encourage every guy, all you guys, all these wonderful things that these older folks have put into us, don't put them in the closet. Let's get them out and use them. Let's go old school. Because that's what this world needs.
Yes,
this world needs some old school.
Yes.
So this man's legacy of love. I'm sure I'm going over my 2 minutes, right?
No, you're good.
It's so important. The word says that God is love, right? It says it in the Old Testament, it says it in the New Testament, right? So that's one thing that we all can agree on, that God is love. So let's just make sure that we love on everybody, regardless of how hot it is in the kitchen, you know? And I know sometimes nobody's perfect. I'm not asking anybody to walk on water. I'm just asking everybody to stop before they say things. and think about it. Stop before they, you guys do things and think about it. And remember, is it necessary? You know, is it necessary that we say those words right then and there? No, because, you know, 5 minutes, our heart's going to change, right? Because emotions are temporary, right? Emotions will trick you. Don't be fooled, guys. The things that our parents and our grandparents taught us, like this great man right here, who is now 7 at the feet of God, happy as all happy can be, right? In a perfect body, no pain. Let's remember this guy. And let's be like him. Let's do like him.
Yes.
And let's not let the enemy dupe us into thinking that we're not worthy and that we don't matter. Because the reality is we all have a circle of influence in our lives. So let's do our very best every day to be a positive influence in our circle of influence.
Exactly.
You know what I mean, guys?
Yes.
It's super important. This is the way that these people live through us. They'll never be forgotten if we continue to operate the way they operate, and we continue to do the things that they taught us to do. Love you guys.
And talk about it.
Yeah. Thank you.
Great, great words of strength and wisdom.
Amen.
Anyone else before we have the family become any other friends of the family? Now we're going to ask that the family would come and they could take as much time as they like, amen, to share their memories of Dad, amen. Brother Tim, you want to come start off?
I've got a lot of fond memories. I think one of the most exciting things that I remember from my dad is, I think I was like 14. There was a father-son picnic at the church that we were attending. And, Dad looks over at me on our way there and he says, "Do you really want to go to this, or do you want to do something like really adventurous?" And, you know, I was 14, I'm like, "Yeah, let's do the adventurous thing." So we sat at a picnic table for about 20 minutes at our destination. It was a park. I think it was in Northville or somewhere out that way. There was a lake. And I was drinking soda pop, and I probably burped like 50 times. He just got a kick out of that, you know, because every time I drink soda pop, man, it really made me belch. But after our picnic, we went for a nature walk, and we found ourselves on a railroad track. And we were just kind of walking along the railroad track, and I was just enjoying Dad, and, you know, we were just kind of enjoying nature. And, you know, we might talk a little bit about the Lord, or he'd talk to me about school, or, you know, some other problems or whatever, you know, happy stuff, you know, stuff like that. And all of a sudden, we're on this train bridge, like, it was like, I don't know if you guys ever saw that movie, Lean on Me.
Yeah.
But there's a scene there where these kids were going across the track and they heard this train coming. And I mean, I'll tell you what, he was behind me and he was yelling, "All right, I think I hear a train." I'm booking it. Man, we made it all the way over to the other side and we're just laughing about it. Well, come to find out that train was, you know, a couple of tracks. You know, it wasn't the train track that we were on. But man, we were laughing about it. And he's like, "I was getting ready to pick you up, just start running with you." He was just all excited about, you know. He's like, "I wouldn't let you," you know, because he's behind me. He's like, "I wouldn't let anything happen to you." You know, that was, you know, pretty exciting. Then, you know, years passed and he came camping with the Boy Scouts and stuff with this group that I was with. I don't think it was the Boy Scouts, but it was a group, like a Christian Boy Scouts, like Rwanda or something like that. And, you know, we spent a lot of time, you know, sitting by campfires and stuff, he always had something really smart to say, you know, about God. And I was always just really just blown away about how much knowledge he had about the Bible and everything like that. I always looked up to him, you know, like a crutch, you know, like, I don't have to study all that. All I got to do is ask him, you know. But, you know, when you're a kid, you know, you want to play, and, you know, so he was like my go-to for learning about God and stuff. If I had any questions, I learned quite a bit. I think the last time we went camping was, about 3 years back, and me and Carla, my wife, and a couple friends, we all hopped in on this canoe and we made a couple of trips out to this island, and I set up camp, and we stayed out on that island for like 2 or 3 days, you know, just camping out, and, you know, I brought a bunch of firewood and stuff, and we had a fire every night, and I made this picnic table out of some wood, like, you know, I took a bunch of wood out there and made a picnic table. We had a swing out there, like a one of those porch swing deals and stuff, and it was so fun just to hang out with him and, you know, just spend quality time, you know, camping and stuff. And, you know, I can remember that he told me, he's like, you make the best camp food, man. You're like, you're cooking up. We had a grill there with propane and stuff and electricity. I had some solar panels set up, and it was, you know, he always kept his cell phone charged, and he was happy about that. I mean, it was comfortable, you know, and he enjoyed that kind of stuff, you know, getting out and enjoying nature and just having a chance to talk to folks, you know. He loved the Lord and he loved people, and he's gonna be missed.
Job than what I had. He wanted me to have something more. He
He called it prestigious. And I told him, I said, I just want to be able to spend time with my family. And he says, yeah, that's exactly what you'll be able to do because you'll have a 9-to-5 job again. And I was like, yeah. I did like going away at night and hanging out with my friends and meeting wonderful people at Elite. And I just loved all the new people I got to meet. All my friends, Maria and Stanley. And those are my friends from work I never would have met if things didn't work the way they did. I'd never take any of that back. I love all my friends. And, oh, I can sit here and name all my friends. Mom can name all her friends, and I'd just be crying, so I better not. But those are things that happen to you, and you never know why they're going to happen. You never know who you're going to meet, you never know who you're going to run into. You never know if you're going to turn around and you're going to meet your very best friend you've never, ever knew could be there for you in a time of need. I had a friend at work, Lizzie, met her just before she came, just after she got to work, and she told her how sorry she was. And I honestly, I didn't remember that she even really thought of me. I was really shocked. And so, Michelle and Jeff, I didn't know I was ever going to meet somebody like you. And Isaac and Mike and Joyce and Wade, my friends and cousins and family. It's like, when you lose somebody, and there are all these people, and Mom's best friend, Betty, and just all of our friends and neighbors or relatives. I'm just so excited to see my friends. And I wish I could name everybody, but my mind's going blank. And our pastor, Larry, and just so good to see you guys. And Aunt Mary, and Uncle Chuck, and Kathy, and David, and Dawn, and just all these people. It's just, and best friends. Just everybody I look at, I just, wow, thank you, and for being here. I can't believe you drove so far, Wade, oh my goodness. I'm sorry, I'm falling apart. But I think he'd be so happy that we have such a support system, and Davey with Charity, and Carla and Tim, and just Mom, and I'm so happy you made it. I was worried about Mom, but she's a trooper. She's amazing. She's a great mom. And like he said, like Steve said, it's just, you never know what's going to happen. Treat everybody right. Sarah, you tell me that every day. You just treat everybody right, you know. And Angie and Grandma and Mom. There's so many people, and Kelly and his wife, and so many people. It's just so wonderful to see you. And I know I have my friends here on YouTube. I hope my family was able to make it. I know Cousin Jim, you guys talk so much. I know you're going to miss him. He's a great man of God, and he loved to talk about God all the time. And he just was so full of knowledge. And I think he'd be really proud of the funeral we put together for him. I think he'd be really happy with all the people that came to share in his wonderful life. He always lived it for other people. And David Hawthorne, if you're out there, he missed you. He wanted to say hi. He was looking for you for a little while. And his brother, Ed Butler, if you're out there, he was thinking of you too. Hoping you're all okay. We're hoping everybody out there and wherever we are and in the land out there, whatever the airways bring you, that you'll see and you'll be able to have your goodbyes too and know that he's with his Lord. He's walking in his garden. He used to take walks. That's what I wanted to say. He used to take walks.
Yep.
He used to take walks every single day, just like that song. He had that relationship with God. And he would just walk and talk, and people were wondering who he was talking to sometimes, but he was just like, you know, it was just, that was Dad. And he would come back and be like, I've had a great idea as I was walking. Yeah. Like, I gotta share it with you. And he'd be like, this is such a great revelation. This is amazing. And he would just share it. And that's one thing he did. He shared his knowledge. He did not keep it bottled up. He even wrote a book. And that book, he wrote that book for how many years of his life?
10.
10 years of his life he wrote this book. He tried to publish it, but when he went to get it printed, the color, I guess, color abilities of printing were not as good as they are now. So he probably could get it printed now, because you can just take a picture of it. Have a video on YouTube. Whatever, you know. But I don't want to take up too much time, but I just wanted to say thank you to everyone.
Christy, tell us one of your fondest memories of Dad.
That's what I was saying. I don't know. I've had so many. I was lucky. I got to spend most of my life with him. I would say I've probably spent my whole life with him. I really never ran off to college where I wouldn't come home. I came home every day, Charity and I. We graduated from Uter College. We stayed with Mom and Dad. When I got married, I even stayed in town because my job was in town. We got a house together. He took care of my child. And I think that's a good time for me to bring up my darling, my sweet Izzy.
My grandpa, he was just awesome. I would want to like brag to everybody about how awesome my grandpa was to me. He was there through everything. He listened to everything I had to say, no matter how stupid it was. Like in freaking fourth grade, I'd tell him about my crushes or whatever. And he just listened, even though it was stupid. And who's going to care about those dumb crushes like when I'm however years old? But he listened because they were important to me at the moment.
Yes.
He took a lot of crap from me too. I was just like constantly bugging him about, like, he was on the computer. I wanted to take the mouse, like there's a little ball on the bottom of the mouse, and play with it. Like, just because I thought it was interesting. He was like, you know, I need that back. And I was like, yeah, like, give it the 30 minutes, I'll be back with the ball. And I'd be like, I don't know later. And he'd be like, he wouldn't say anything because he knew I was having fun. He always did stuff for me. We went for walks together in like Davison Park. We had so much fun on our walks. We walked like, how many miles do you think that was to the park part of the park? You know, the park part where we went out like that Girl Scout thing.
2 miles?
It was a pretty long, he was like tired, he was sweating. And then I wanted to go get some food after, so we walked like to Hannah's Market. That was our place. We used to go to Hannah's Market a lot, get food. He'd get me whatever snacks I wanted. Ugh, he just spoiled me. He did listen to me just talk about dumb stuff. We just had so much fun together. I'd sit on his lap and we'd watch movies on his computer together. We watched E.T. That one I didn't even know you'd go with me.
You want to know how much fun is look at the pictures.
Oh, yeah, that was my best friend. Me and my grandpa always together doing something. He got a little older. He promised me he wouldn't walk by himself because he fell on a construction site. Good to see. And I was like, Grandpa, please don't. I'll take you. And after I drove, I took him to the store. But I'd walk him, like, tiptoe him across the icy parts of the sidewalk. And he'd be like, thank you so much for helping. He was always so gracious of just something little I did. He was very gracious. Even anybody, he'd be gracious. He was just a great guy and so supportive. He was there for me when my parents got divorced. He played kind of like a father figure. Just always there for me. And we just have so many memories because he's been there since day one, supporting me, telling me I was smart and talented, and like telling my stories to everybody. Like, my granddaughter is the best. And I was like, I am not. And he'd be like, you are. And then he just lists the reasons. But he was just so nice to everyone he met. He'd talk your ear off too, because he'd let you know about his things about the Lord and all of that. He let you know what he believed, and he was great. He was just the best, and I'm so very thankful I got to have him in my life, because he was just, like I said, he's the best. And if anyone else has anything to say about him, feel free.
missed the friends part, but
your family, Mike.
I'm kind of family. My name's Mike Merwin. I grew up with them real young. For many years, I was maybe one of the only friends that, you know, they let's stay the night over the house when we're talking. So I'm searching my memory banks for some unique things about what I remember about Mr. Butler. And kind of a little levity here, he had this really uncanny ability. He was cross-eyed. He could watch two shows at the same time and tell you what was going on with each show. I would literally watch him downstairs. He had this computer set up. He could work on the computer and watch the movie at the same time. Those are true stories.
Oh my goodness.
I remember going on many walks with him also. At night, he really liked to watch the stars and talk about his belief in the Lord. And, you know, even one unique thing about him, even if he didn't agree with your opinion, he would still listen to you, and he'd have a debate, and he'd tell you why you were wrong. he would still listen to you from your point of view. And a memory that I want to share, you know, he was never really a man of means. But one thing, his children, he passed on being humble and appreciating what you got. I remember we went to the park one day, and all we had was cardboard boxes that we set up on the grass. And we're sliding down the slide, making our own sledding hill out of cardboard boxes. And we had, and all of a sudden everybody starts laughing because Mrs. Butler, you know, is saying, "Don't get grass stained, don't get grass stained." But everybody didn't hear grass. They heard just the last three letters. And everyone was shocked, saying, "What were you saying?" And then, of course, it was clarified. But we went to Toys R Us afterwards, and I just remember, again, not having a lot of means. You know, the only thing that he could get, Charity got a balloon, and it was like, she was like, "This is the best balloon I've ever had." So I hope I, you know, add a little bit of love and levity to what is a sad day, but it is a homecoming.
Yes.
He is sent home.
Yes.
He was a man of his beliefs.
Yes.
And like I said, even if you didn't agree with him, you gotta follow your beliefs, whether other people agree with you or not.
Yes.
That's one thing he did.
Yes.
So.
That's right.
Great job. Thank you for those memories. I just want to say thank you everybody for showing up. I only got to get close to my grandfather the last 8 months. And he always loved to watch Dukes of Hazzard with me, and he'd watch Smallville with me.
Yeah.
He would enjoy coming out to the living room and sitting on the couch, and we would watch the good old boys get chased by Roscoe and Enos Sprigg. And he enjoyed when I made him some homemade chicken in the new wave oven. He said that, "I really love your new wave chicken. It's really awesome and it tastes good." And we would go for a walk here and there together around the corner, and he would get me some snacks later when I was hungry. And when grandma would get out of the kitchen, we would get some food to make. And he was a really awesome grandpa, and I'm glad I got to get close to with him the last 8 months. And now he's up in heaven.
That's right.
So, thank you.
Thank you.
Adopted him. He said, I'm not your dad. I said, well, are now. It made him feel good. I said, you really showed me some things. And I'm telling you, Dad, you could have a conversation with Dad for about an hour, and you would walk away. He said, Dad, hey, excuse me, I gotta go to the bathroom. I'll be right back. I'll be right back. I promise. I'll come right back. He said, I'll be waiting for you. And so I go to the bathroom, and wash my hands, and I come back, and Dad will start right
where
he. I'm like, how did you do that? This man, I think he was like a computer or something. He could download all this stuff. And I didn't take very many walks with him, but at Meyer's grocery store, he liked to go to Christie's samples every once in a while and get the samples and see what. And we would pretend that we didn't know Christy, because, you know, there's rules. So we walk up there, well, how are you today? What are you doing today? No one knew that we knew. Dad really had a hard time with that. Because at that time at all. And Dad really... Right, Dad really... He loved the Bible. I mean, this man... He didn't need the Word of God. He memorized this thing. I'm like, how do you? I mean, the Holy Spirit on him, and he would tell you everything. I said, wait, Dad, what do you know about this? Boom. Scripture, Timothy, 2 Timothy, whatever. He knew all those scriptures. He loved to get in the car and just talk about everything, about life, about Christy, and. And I'm telling you, he loved every family member here. He talked about everybody, Charity, and Mom, and he loved all his friends and family. And his favorite restaurant was Empire Walk.
Yep.
He liked to go there. We try to switch it on him. We say, hey, let's go to the hibachi. What do you think about that? He goes, he knew he was disappointed when you mentioned it. Why did you say that? We should have looked at Empire Walk.
Yeah.
But the knowledge that this man leaves for us in the legacy is just live for God. He would want everybody here to live for Jesus and love people. He loved everybody. I brought a stranger over. Well, he wasn't really a stranger, but he was a friend. He loved him like a family member. He treated him, and they talked about the Bible and everything. So, what a great man. And the last 2 weeks of spending time with Dad, and he was really proud of Christy to go and apply for that job. Yeah, and Christy was really strong to go to that interview. He talked about Charity and her master's degree, and he was really proud of her. And little Jakey here, he got to spend the birthday party last year with Jake. He really enjoyed talking to Jake on the phone. Grandpa Butler said, show his face.
Because
he was used to Facebook. He said, get him back on the face. He didn't want to, see his face. So he really enjoyed talking. And so, thank you guys for being here and celebrating Dad. I appreciate it. Yes,
Sam.
This is not easy.
I know, right?
I'm not family, but they made me feel family.
Oh,
and
yes,
you are.
You had a wonderful testimony.
Your family.
And we talked to Marcia. And if we didn't know something, we always asked Tim. Tim would give us a full explanation of whatever it was.
No.
And I went through this a couple of years ago, and our Calm family, they were there for me. They were there, and I could always count on them to be there when I needed them, and I always talk to Marcia. I love you, Marcia. The Lord is faithful.
Yes.
With the help of friends, and He will lead you to all, I mean, the whole family.
And Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering and laid it upon Isaac, his son. And he took the fire in his hand and a knife. And they went both of them together. And Isaac spake unto Abraham, his father, and said, my father. He said, here am I, my son. And he said, behold the fire and the wood, but where is the lamb for the burnt offering? And Abraham said, my son, God will provide himself a lamb for the burnt offering. So they went both of them together. This particular passage of scripture reminds me
of Pastor Tim, because it deals with a man, his faith, and his family. And that's what Pastor Tim was all about, his faith and his family. And before I finish this, he was adventurous as well. And I know everybody thinks of Pastor Tim and the clean living that he lived, but I want to tell you guys about his criminal history. Pastor Tim, myself, and Tim were together at our church. So we decided, did you ever notice that each one of the stories involved food or snacks? So we were on our way to get food. We left the church. We were on our way to get food. Tim Jr. is driving. Okay. We get stopped by the railroad tracks. The arm comes down. Tim Jr. decides we could beat this. I'm in the front seat with Tim. Pastor Tim in the back seat. Tim decides to go around the arm.
Oh my goodness.
And then we notice the cops. So the lights come on, but they got blocked. So we had a little ways to get.
It was a blizzard.
It was a blizzard as well. Thank you for reminding me. So we had options here. Either we surrender to the cops or we give it our best effort. Now this is why we shouldn't be Facebook Live. You know? Tim is still here. It's all on Tim.
Four-wheel drive.
So Tim said, we're going to go for it. So I said, listen, we only had the option of getting caught and we all go to jail. But I aided and abetted him and said, no, go left. And go right. Go up this hill. Turn. Pastor Tim in the back seat holding on for dear life. But we escaped the police. So he wasn't all that holy, y'all. But I love Pastor Tim. This man loved the Lord with all his heart. He loved his wife and his children, his grandchildren. He loved his family. He loved everyone. And what we see here, and I'm through, because you guys did a great job in eulogizing him. The thing that intrigued me in this scripture was Isaac. Isaac had noticed that something was missing. And the only way that Isaac could have known that something was missing is because he knew what constituted worship because his dad had taught him.
Right.
They were going up to, and he says, we're going up to worship and we'll return. God had required him to sacrifice his son. But his faith spoke to the gentleman and he says, me and the lad, we're going a little further, but we will what? Return. Well, how is it that you're going to return if God asks you to sacrifice? But he had some faith in God. That God wouldn't give me something and then take it away from me. So he said to his son, let's go ahead and let's make this sacrifice. But the son was curious. He was like, Dad, something's missing. But the only way he could know that something was missing is if his dad told him and taught him what constitutes worship. Likewise, Pastor Tim shared with his sons, his daughter, his family, all of us, what constitutes worship. Amen. And so we know when something is missing because he taught us. our faith should be shared with our family first. Amen. And he did just that. And so we celebrate today. Again, there's a mixed emotion. We're going to miss him, but he's not lost. We know where he is. He's in the bosom of the Lord. Amen. 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 Right now, as they write, yes. If you allow me some poetic justice, he's right now talking God's ear off. I knew exactly what you meant, God, in Isaiah, and how it connected to Joel. And matter of fact, in my book, God, I had made this notation. Pure heart. Pure heart. As our brother said over there, we would do ourselves a great disservice if we left all of the wisdom and the knowledge that he shared with us. This man was a genius.
Yes.
Amen. And as you shared, sometimes we die in the faith. We die believing God. Amen. Brother Tim will share with me how he used to be an engineer at Ford, and then some things happened, and he went back to school. But when he finished school, things weren't. He didn't come back like he thought he was, and it broke him. It hurt him, you know. But God had a plan for him.
Yes.
Amen. And we were all privileged to be a part of that plan. So as we dismiss from this place, they're going to share another song. Brother, How Great Thou Art is going to be played for us. And then after that song, Brother Nick is going to come for our dismissal. And then we'll be dismissed on He Washed My Eyes with His Tears. But right now, lend your ears to How Great Thou Art.
My God, how great thou art. On behalf of Pastor Tim's loving family, I'd like to thank all of you for your presence here today. This concludes our services here in the Swartz Funeral Home Chapel. In just a moment, we're going to be dismissing row by row, so you all have an opportunity to pass by Pastor Tim's casket the final time, and of course by his loving family. As you exit the chapel this afternoon, I'd like to welcome you to your vehicles in our anticipation for the procession to Evergreen Cemetery. Please note, when we exit the parking lot this afternoon, we'll be taking a left out of the parking lot. Due to the construction on Hill Road, we're going to be taking an alternate route to Evergreen Cemetery. Our service will conclude there in the cemetery's chapel. I'd like to welcome the pallbearers to gather outside the doors here by the grandfather clock once they've had their final goodbyes with Pastor Tim. And I would be remiss not to mention our sincere thanks and appreciation to Pastor Larry Spann and his wife LaMarcia for the beautiful song Amazing Grace that she sang here today. So in just a moment, we'll come row by row, and please come up to see Pastor Tim and his family a final time. Thank you. I had also forgot to mention, after Evergreen Cemetery, you are all welcome to Pastor Tim's favorite restaurant, Empire Walk. So that's on Court Street in Burton. If you do need further directions, please come to me and I will give them to you. Thank you. There's also 10% off if you will come, and free drinks.
Yeah.
newspapers on.
That's me. See me, the man. I had you. I'm the baby.
Isn't that cool? That's Grandpa's car. And that right there, that's Grandpa's.
That's his pot.